Thank you, President James, and it's really exciting for me anyway to have another one of our candidates here who will be running for U.S. Congress for District 1, and his name is Rich Ashooh. To tell you a little bit about Rich, he is a businessman, a civic leader, and an activist. And for 20 years, he worked as a senior executive for Sanders, and then for the BAE Systems, which is a global aerospace company. Rich has been in business and a volunteer in the communities. He has served on many boards, including the New Hampshire Business and Industry Association, the New England Council, and the National Defense Industrial Association. And for higher education, he's been very involved in that also. He has served as a trustee for the University System of New Hampshire, a trustee for Franklin Pierce University, and he's been past chairman of the Krista McAuliffe Allen Shepherd Discovery Center Commission. And he has been involved with many institutions as well. He has served as on the Catholic Medical Center in Manchester. He has served on the Adult Learning Center in Nashua and the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation and New Hampshire Public Television. So, and for support of veterans, he has been involved with the Easter Seals Veterans Count Program and has been a dedicated volunteer to Liberty House. He has also chaired the Josiah Bartlett Center for Public Policy, which is a think tank and has been very important in New Hampshire. He is a graduate of the University of New Hampshire, and he lives in Bedford with his wife, Lori, and their 5 children. So today I want to introduce Rich Ashooh, candidate for Congress First District. Thank you.
Can you make a command decision and take this mic? Tough luck if it's not. Thank you for having me, Jim. And Stella, I can't say enough. Although you said enough. We'll have to trim that down. I will wander a little bit. I love the stately appearance of the podium and the flags, but I'm trying to win a race. I'm not in it. Yeah, we'll move over there if we're successful. I'm so pleased, Stella, that you mentioned UNH in particular, because that is, like you, where I met my spouse. We're near the great waters of Great Bay, which is where I courted my wife. We were both on the rowing team. And she was a coxswain, so similar to Stella. In the industry that I came out of, Stella would be described as small form factor, large power output. My wife's the same way. She's the coxswain, right? The boss of the boat, and I was a rower. So, coxswain say, rower do. And the relationship has not changed at all. Put in the 5 kids, and you know what our home life is like. And basically, if I've had any success, it's because I've just done what my wife has said. Right, Basil? You know what I'm talking about? Amazing. Simple. So again, so grateful to be here. I will warn you, though, because I did court my wife on the waters of Great Bay, that wonderful smell does kind of bring feelings of seduction. So if I work too hard to get your vote, you'll know why. I'm not going to take too much time. Thankfully, I don't have to go into the background. That was a very nice and gracious introduction. So I won't spend a lot of time on the bio. I think I'd like to tell you a little bit about why I'm running, and then devote as much time as we can to questions, if that's okay. And as far as the why I'm running, that is a question that comes a lot, only it's never why are you running, it's always why are you running? In particular this year. This has been the most unusual year politically I think many of us have ever experienced, let alone heard about. And certainly as a candidate, that is also quite true. But the fact of the matter is, the fact that it's an unusual year is only reinforcing why this election is so important. Across the board, Americans are not happy with the way things are going, and they are expressing that in many ways, and as I said, unusual ways. And for me, I have to put myself in the same category of someone who is not happy with the way things have been going. We have a number of problems in this nation that simply have not been solved, and they need to be. If we are to remain the country that we say we are and have been, then some things do need to change, and we need to be thoughtful about what that change is. Now, there's a long list of problems. I won't go into all of them, but I will go into the ones that motivated me to run. The first is certainly fiscal responsibility. We haven't had a balanced budget in more than 20 years. Now, this is a largely business-dominated crowd. That would be unacceptable to any of you. Why should it be acceptable at the federal level? Nobody budgets this way. They don't budget at all. It has been year after year of kludging something together, and most Americans experience the federal budget through this standoff at the end of the year over whether to shut down the government. That's no way for government to express itself to citizens. No wonder people are so upset. No wonder they're so upset. We have a debt, a national debt of $19 trillion. Now, Stella mentioned I went to UNH. Right after I graduated, I was honored to work for two U.S. senators, Gordon Humphrey and Warren Rubin. And Warren Rubin at the time was known as a deficit fighter. And at that time, the national debt was about $3 trillion. And we had chronic deficit spending, and we thought it was bad then. Now, chronic deficit spending and a debt of $19 trillion. In terms of the ratio, how important is that? 3 trillion versus 19. Well, 3 trillion was about 30% of our GDP. And again, we thought that was bad. The 19 trillion, 70% of our GDP. Hasn't been that high since World War II. And in World War II, we had very good reasons to go into that kind of debt. We don't now. We need to change something. Everything we say we want to do as a nation is contingent upon getting our fiscal house in order, and we haven't. The second thing that is a problem that I believe I can help with is national security. We've seen an evolution of the threats against this nation. It's the sort of threat that does not respect borders, does not respect boundaries. The danger can occur anywhere, as the newspapers reinforce every day. We have no coherent strategy to counter the global threat of terrorism that we're dealing with. And it's not a new threat. Whether it's ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Taliban, Hezbollah, we have been dealing with this, and we haven't solved it. We have no strategy right now. Worse, our adversaries are emboldened, such as Iran and North Korea, and our allies are shaken. It should be the other way around. It should be the other way around, and yet it is not. Now, we've had 8 years of a president who I happen to believe was not well suited to be commander-in-chief. It's not why he ran, it's not part of his background, and I believe we are paying a price for that. When that happens, and it can happen, you need a Congress that can stand up to the challenges. And the more than 20 years experience I have in national security, I believe is particularly relevant to this particular problem. Finally, the economy. It should be surging. It's improving largely because of the intrepid nature of people in this room and others like you who are able to overcome obstacles. Well, they shouldn't have to overcome government obstacles. Yes, that's exactly what we have. We have government obstacles. We have taxes that are too high. The U.S. tax code is uncompetitive on the global market, 35%, the highest in the civilized world. We haven't had meaningful tax reform since the 80s. It's time to address the tax code. It's time to undo the overregulation that we've seen over the past 8 years. Well-intended efforts that choke business, choke the economy, kill competition, pick winners and losers. When it comes to the economy and government, less is more. There are many, many other issues. The fact of the matter is, though, it's not going to be about issues. I happen to believe, as we've seen reinforced through the ballot box, that Americans have lost faith in their public officials to solve the problems. And there's good reasons for them to feel that way. I'm running as a Republican, but I'll tell you, it's not just about being a Republican. We've had Republican majorities in both the House and the Senate, and the problem still persists. So what needs to change? You need the right kind of Republican. You need the right kind of people, people with experience. I believe my business experience, my national security experience, and my experience in the community suit me well for the problems that we have now. And I'm hoping you will agree, which is why I'm here today. It's to ask for your vote. At the end of the day, nobody has all the answers. But this is an incredible state and an incredible district. The amazing work that goes on in this district, I've been blessed to learn as I go all around the district. And so while I may not have all the answers, and I'm confident that I have some, in fact, the most critical ones, I believe this district does. And I believe it's my job to take those answers to Washington, which is a short way of saying, you're all going to solve the problems and I'm going to just take credit for it. I'm joking, but that is the job. The job is to represent the people of New Hampshire. And the fact is that this congressional seat that I am running for has changed hands. It's gone Democrat, Republican, for the past 10 years. Well, I don't think the people in this room, the people outside of this room, I don't think they're that fickle. I don't think they're changing like a pendulum, their views. I think they're questing, looking for something that works. I believe I have that. I will work hard to earn your trust. I will say what I'm going to do and do it. And I will always be accessible to you so that we can continue this conversation, because it is a conversation. It's not about September, the primary, and it's not about November, the election. It's about January. It's about winning the country back. And we need to get it done. With your help, I believe I can do that. Thank you very much for the time today, and I'd love to take your questions.
Thank you very much. You mentioned the word solving problems several times in your presentation, and you know, that's the thing I'm looking for most in anybody I vote for right now. It seems like whether you're in the House or the Senate in our government, or whether you're running for the president, that people are more interested in being right than they are in actually solving a problem. And I'd like to hear what you can do as one person in that big body.
Thank you. That's very well put. You know, there's words to look out for in politics. When someone says, I fought for this and fought for that, that's often code for, I failed. Well, think about it. There's a few people here. My family's a farming background, right? And farming is a meritocracy. You show up, you work hard, you put in the time, you're rewarded for it. Politics is not that. We are rewarding people for failure, for standing on principle, but then not getting it done. That is an equation that needs to change. By the way, it doesn't need to change with me. It needs to change with the voters. The voters need to stop rewarding inaction, failure, lack of success. You don't have to compromise your principles. In fact, I'm a fairly conservative person. I happen to believe that if people know that about me, then it's easier to deal with me. Having clear principles makes it easier, and on the other side, I think that's true. I greatly look forward to a contest against Carol Shea Porter, because I believe we'll present distinctions that'll be very clear for people, and it'll be a good discussion. What can one person do? Well, there's a history of that in New Hampshire. I mentioned earlier that I worked for two people. When I was young, got out of school, went to Washington, and worked for, again, Gordon Humphrey, Warren Rudman. Now, some of you may know those names, some of you may not. But if you do know them because in their field, they were known as leaders. Gordon Humphrey on national security, in particular Afghanistan, and Warren Rudman on the debt and the deficit. And they both accomplished things because they were known as leaders, knew what they were doing, put in the time, and were able to bring others with them. That is leadership. That is not a new idea. We simply have forgotten to reinforce it as voters in the ballot box. That's the lesson that I would learn. On the issues that I talked about, I believe I know enough and will work hard enough to be a leader on those issues and rally people to solve those problems.
Wait. I don't know if I can get there in time.
I'm Russell.
I'm going to ask you a question. Glass-Steagall was repealed in the 90s in Republican Congress. What do you think of that?
what I think of the repeal.
Yes.
So there's a long list of banking regulations that we need to look at again. Okay? Now, I would actually, you can stand up again. Do you want to remind everybody about Glass-Steagall?
Glass-Steagall, was a law that was passed in the 30s after the Great Recession that separated certain financial institutions from doing the same business.
Yeah, and in the wake of the financial crisis, there's a current debate over whether it should be reinstated in some way. My view is there's a long list of banking regulations that we need to look at again. Okay, absolutely Dodd-Frank. How many bankers are in this room today? How many of you are suffering under Dodd-Frank? Yeah, okay, so I think there was what I consider to be an overcorrection regarding regulations in the wake of the crisis. And it's still amazingly hard to get access to capital. If you're a small business, it's very, very hard. And we're not gonna supercharge this economy. On Glass-Steagall itself, it would really depend on what we're gonna do about it. Because I don't think we wanna roll the clock back, but I absolutely think it needs to be on the table as something we look at. Yes, sir.
What's your opinion on the effectiveness of term limits on breakers?
So I'm a supporter of term limits, but as I think most people know, to have term limits in law, you would need to amend the Constitution. And so what I don't want to tell people is I'm for term limits, knowing legal term limits are unlikely to happen just because it's a hard thing to do. I'm a big believer in disincentivizing longevity. I think that's the best way to have effective term limits, right? You know, one thing is, you know, Congress rewards seniority. The longer you're there, the more power you get, the more benefits you get, and things like that. I believe in term limiting committee chairmen so they don't stay sitting on top of these committees forever. That's one way to disincentivize it. I think, and I don't think this would make me many friends, but I would also hold the pay flat. You go in at a certain salary, and that just doesn't go up while you're there. I think after 3-4 terms, people might start thinking about leaving. I think those are effective ways to have effective term limits. I would self-impose. You know, I can't see myself, as you've heard, this is not my career. I believe this is more of a mission. And a mission has a defined ending, and I would, you know, certainly after 3-4 terms, I'd be gone. Oh, I wish I were an engineer.
Well,
I just translate for them.
Yes, that's what I'm talking about. So there's pieces of him that this what he's talking about is not doing what he's doing. A personal 2 years ago, New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority sent me down as a delegate to learn about the financial crisis. We sat with Kelly Ayotte, we sat with GHD, there was 8 of us, and we represent RMS. I was from Merrimack Community Savings Bank at the time. And so they had a mixture between 8 different banks. And we represented $98 million of business. So people actually listened to us. And I sat down with Kelly and I said, Kelly, we've got a big issue. I said, we want our kids to go to school, but we don't want to allow them to then further their life because of how we set up their repayment plans. So when they go to buy a mortgage. And I know all of us kind of suffer with that in our mortgage industry. It's like, you do not have people communicating in Washington, D.C. And in this small trip that I've taken, 4 days, there are so many disconnected items. And an engineered mind connects those two things. So I can imagine when you're looking at everything that's going on, your brain is going to come wild. And I don't know how, every time I've spoken to you, you've been on a campaign trail for a long time. He's never taken credit at VA. I mean, I don't know him personally. I just know him professionally and representing numbers of people throughout New Hampshire in good and positive ways. So I don't think what you're saying, I mean, you got my vote, but I wish I could express more the impression you leave upon people.
Julie, we're out of time.
But you made an impression on me.
Thank you, Julie. Thank you, Julie. Yeah, that means a lot. Yeah.
I wonder where you stand on the no labels movement.
No labels movement. That was prominent during the presidential primary. Very sympathetic to the goal, which is to get leaders to think beyond their particular party label. I don't believe in a world without party labels. I believe they're important. As I said, I believe it's important for people to know where I stand on the spectrum. I think it makes working together easier. So I don't believe people should shed, you know, what they identify with. But the goal, which is setting aside those labels in order to make progress, that is something we need to do. I'm hearing it everywhere. This is my view. I'm running as a Republican and for the Republican nomination. Here's my view of how the parties ought to work. I believe parties are a vehicle. It's a vehicle, it's a car. You get in and you drive to a certain place. In my case, I'm getting in my Ford F-150 because that's what Republicans drive, and they go to Congress. And then when you get there, and Democrats drive Subarus. So, tell me I'm wrong. I'm kidding. So you get in the car, you drive, in my case, to Congress, and when you get there, you get out of the car, and you go into the Capitol, and you do what you need to do. The vehicle has its role, but it's just that. It's a vehicle. It is not something you take into Congress and drive around the floor. So that is my approach. And I know we're out of time. I saw her back there, and I don't see her now, but I just wanted to thank Peggy for her family sacrifice and also tell her that I'm still sore from the Chief Malone road race back a couple months ago. But I think reminding us all why we do what we do, I think, is important for, you know, whether you're a candidate or a community leader or a business person, having that sense of why we do what we do. And in our case, you know, it's certainly to leave our country a better place for our children than we got. And that's what I'm hoping to do. So thank you very much.
So, Rich, we have a gift for you, and you made it clear you're a fiscal conservative. So if in fact you do get to Congress, you will not need to order pens. This is the Portsmouth Rotary pen, just a token of our appreciation for you coming today. Thank you very much.